You can all hear me? First of all, the title, Leadership Training at Maersk. I don't teach leadership. I'm in charge of our technology programs here at Maersk College, information systems, you know, IT, computer science, and our mathematics programs as well. However, as part of those programs, we certainly try to make certain that our students, you know, have the ability to grow as leaders. So I'm speaking to you from that perspective of you're working with students in the area of information technology, computer science, and mathematics. So, sort of a quick overview of what it is I'm going to be talking about today. First of all, I'll talk a little bit about leadership, but from various experts other than me, who I don't consider an expert in the area of leadership. We'll also talk about Maersk's perspective in terms of leadership, not only in terms of my program, but in terms of the entire college. We'll also talk about what successful graduates of Maersk College, people who've become CTOs, CEOs, CFOs, what they think was important about their education 10, 20, and even in one case, 30 years after they left Maersk College. And then I'll also tell you a little bit about some of the Maersk College programs that we have. I mentioned leaders in technology. We've been very successful. Our students have been very successful. This is just a sublist of some of the leaders who are out there currently, who've graduated from my programs. I've been here, by the way, at Maersk College for 31 years, so most everybody that's still alive and working out there, you know, went through me. So, you know, Goldman Sachs, for instance, one of the managing partners of Goldman Sachs, a graduate of our program, who might end up being their next CIO. A managing director of technology at Goldman Sachs, vice president of network architecture, in charge of the entire network architecture associated with Goldman Sachs worldwide. IBM, we're loaded with people at IBM. We have a general manager, 9 vice presidents, 6 directors. Morgan Stanley, vice president, global head of Windows virtualization and remote computing engineering, EMC, executive vice president, CTO, the director of West Coast Research, iSpace, one of the top fastest growing technology minority companies in Los Angeles. 3 people there, they're actually all Maersk College graduates. I actually started that particular company. As I said, I'm not an expert in terms of leadership, so I want to take a little bit from some experts out there. So where I'm going to show you a video of one of those experts I hope we can learn something from.
I find that education, I think it don't matter where you go to school, Italy, America, Brazil, it's all the same. It's all just memorization. And it don't matter how long you can remember anything, just so you can pair it at the back for the test. And I got this idea for a school I would like to start. Something called the 5-Minute University. And the idea is that in 5 minutes, you learn what the average college graduate remembers 5 years after he or she's out of school. Would the cost of like $20? That might seem like a lot of money, $20 just for 5 minutes. But that's for like a tuition, cap and gown rental, graduation picture, snacks, everything. Everything included. You know, like in college, you have to take a foreign language. Well, at the 5-minute university, you can have your choice. Any language you want, you can take it. Say if you want to take Spanish, what I teach you is, ¿Cómo está usted? That means, how are you? And the answer is muy bien, means very well. And believe me, if you took 2 years of college Spanish, 5 years after you're out of school, ¿Cómo está usted muy bien? About all you're gonna remember. So in my school, that's all you learn. You see, you don't have to waste your time with the conjugations, vocabulary, all that junk. You just forget it anyway, and what's the difference? Economics, supply and demand. That's it. business. Business is you buy something and you sell it for more. Theology, I'm going to have a theology department, you know, since I'm a priest, it's only right. And what you have to learn in theology is the answer to the question, where is God? And the answer is, God is everywhere. Why? Because he likes you. That's kind of a combination of the Disney and Roman Catholic philosophies. It's just a perfect for the late 70s or early 80s, you know? Just a perfect. Well, after the courses are all over, then it's a time for a little Easter vacation. No time to go to Fort Lauderdale. Only lasts like 20 seconds. But what I do for you, I like to turn on a sun lamp. You know, I give you a little glass of orange juice. That's the snack part, orange juice. And then after vacation, you know, after you swallow it real quick, then it's a time for the final exams. I say to you, como está usted? You say, muy bien. Where is God? The God is everywhere. Economics is supply and demand. Then I put on your cap and a gown. I get out to my Polaroid, the camera, you know, make a little snap and flash a picture for you. I give you the picture. You give me $20. I give you a diploma and your college graduate ready to go. I'm not sure, but I'm pretty sure, right next door to the 5-Minute University, I might have opened up a little law school. You know, you got another minute?
Okay, I hope we've gained a lot from that. Hopefully, the graduates that I talk about that have, you know, gone on to become, you know, presidents, CTOs, CIOs, and so forth, learn perhaps a little bit, you know, more than that, but maybe not. So what I wanted to do for you is to create one of a course for, you know, Father Guido Sarducci's 5-Minute University. So I have one associated with leadership. And these are the five things you need to remember in order to pass that final exam associated with leadership. And that leadership entails vision. So vision, you have to remember. Remember, vision. There will indeed be a test. And vision is an important component associated with leadership. In order for you to be able to lead, you have to have a vision. You have to be able to be forward-thinking, about thinking about, you know, not only what you need to do in order to, you know, survive the day, but what are you going to do in terms of the future. Values, number two. Values. You need to understand the values associated with your company that's going to direct, influence you as you lead towards that vision. You also have to understand your own values in terms of, you know, what things are going to guide you as an individual in terms of, you know, working with the company. Communication skills. One of the things about communication skills is not just simply a one-way street. Communication skills isn't just simply your ability to talk, but it's also your ability to listen, your ability to work with the people that you're working with. Role modeling. You need, in order to be a leader, you need to be a role model. You have to be able to lead by example. You can't just simply come up with what your vision for the company, your values for the company, and then sit back and you know, let everybody proceed. You must be a role model for people to be able to you know, follow, to lead. And you must have confidence. And again, confidence, like communication, is really a two-way street. You need to have the confidence in yourself to be able to lead, but you also have to have the confidence in your people in order for you to be able to lead them. So again, a two-way street. So these are the five things. The five-minute you know, course for Guido Sarducci is now over. I will be taking photographs in the back, collecting $5. I believe you've already had your snacks, so no snacks will be included. few wise words as we go along from various people. What we want to do is relate this back to the five Guido Sarducci things you must learn associated with leadership. It's hard to lead a cavalry charge if you think you look funny on a horse, by Adlai Stevenson. Which one of those five characteristics does this relate back to? Confidence, right? You must have confidence in yourself if you're going to lead. You can't be looking funny on, I think you look funny on a horse and be able to lead that cavalry. So, I mentioned also that I wanted to talk about experts in terms of what experts' opinions are in terms of leadership. And this was actually from a paper that appeared in the Harvard Business Journal. It was written by Boris Groysberg, L. Kevin Kelly, and Owen Bryan. Ooh, somebody, the name got lost. And what they're talking about in terms of the C-suite, of course, is the suite that you all sit in. You're all CIO, so you sit in the C-suite for the CIO. So it also talks about the CFO, the CEO, the CTO. What are the various characteristics that people need in order to move into that C-suite? One of the unique things about the your position, positions of CIO, is it's a very new position. It's probably less than 20 years old in terms of it existing and as in many places as it currently does exist. Before that, there was directors of IT, and directors of IT were really quite different than their roles were quite different than the role of a CIO. Directors of IT, I remember the ones we had 30 years ago when I was here at Marist College, or some of them along the way, tend to be much more insular. They really weren't necessarily part of guiding the entire organization. They were responsible for their little silo, and they protected their silo and so forth. And so the information from this particular research study done was actually gained by looking at talking to, communicating with a number of high-profile recruiters, people recruiting, organizations recruiting for major industry, academia, and it was interesting in terms of some of the results. I'm going to only tell you a little bit about what they had to say about the CIO. Key findings. Once people reach the C-suite, technical and functional expertise matters less than leadership skills and a strong grasp of business fundamentals. If you remember in my five characteristics for the Guido course, there was nothing in there associated with technical skills. I'm not saying that technical skills did not get you to where you are, but those technical skills the need for those tends to dissipate a bit once you reach that position of being CIO. I'm sure if you're in the position of being CIO for 10 years or so, some of your strong technical skills might actually disappear. And so remember, this is actually based upon what these companies were seeking in terms of somebody to sit in their position as the CIO. They were not asking for strong technical skills. Chief information officers need to know how to create business models. Nowadays, the CIO is really part of the whole organization. New requirements for the CIO, again, based upon what was being looked for in terms of these high-profile searches. One, the ability to view the business holistically across functional unit and regional boundaries. It is no longer simply the function of an IT director in terms of running their silo, making certain some technology is available. They must be able to view the entire organization across all the units. One of the things that Bill mentioned in terms of something that we do here at Marist College, we do indeed function across regional boundaries. Process orientation and comfort with organizational design. Again, The CIO is no longer simply an IT director. That person is someone that has to be involved in organizational design, redesigning the organizational structure associated with the company. Processes have to be well understood so that they can be explained across the organization. Another important area, information analytics knowledge, ability to help companies sort through and use information, a very important component in terms of the job requirements for CIOs at these particular companies. They must understand business analytics. They need to be able to understand decision support systems, how those support systems are going to help the not only the IT department be successful, but the entire organization become successful. Expertise in investment allocation and using return on investment to make decisions about future IT expenditures. Every time Bill needs to, puts in a request for something, something large, the return investment has to be there. The business plan has to be there. How that's going to affect the organization in terms of future IT expenditures. A CEO's expectations of a CIO. A discussion about expansion into a new market. These are things that the CEO is going to expect to be able to have a discussion with their CIOs about. The CEO can go to the CIO and say, look, we want to look about expanding into a new market. How does this affect our organization? How does this affect our IT structure? Do we have the IT to be able to deal with this? These types of questions need to be able to be answered by the CIO. How the firm's systems could support that expansion, as I just said. What would the challenges be? So one needs to understand certainly technology at the level to be able to answer questions associated with the challenges, but once that is sort of pulled out of the way, the CIO is not going to be the person that's going to implement that. It's going to be the CIO's team that does that. What would be the long-term impact of the IT expenditures required to support the expansion? So again, business plans, really understanding how that decision is going to affect not only what you need today, but what you're going to need in the future. How is it going to affect the processes associated with the organization? Pull the string and it will follow wherever you wish. Push it and it will go nowhere at all. Dwight Eisenhower. Which one of our five characteristics do we think? Maybe communication, perhaps, could be one, Anita Rice. The Marist College was awarded an NSF grant around 5 years ago, in which we were asked to put together a video that could actually be used by organizations related to women in technology. It was really about women who become leaders in the area of technology. So we have six people that we actually interviewed. One, Linda Sanford. I think, did Linda speak here last night? Linda Sanford. I want to show you one associated with Anita Rice.
Successful two-session symposium a couple of weeks ago, and it's all about leadership development, but I wanted Judy to give you some feedback on what the participants told us. So Judy?
As Anita just mentioned, we had a wonderful time at the seminar, and I just want to share.
I'm a senior development manager, and I'm responsible for recruiting, retention, leadership development, some of the climate in our environment. So on a daily basis, I'm mentoring, coaching, responding to questions, ensuring that everyone on my team is doing what they should to make the organization better.
What helped you decide in a career in enterprise computing?
I have a real interest in women and women in the workplace. So I chose sociology because of its study in dealing with individuals in their environment, and management does the same thing. I try to deal with individuals in a management capacity and how they deal with their peers, with the environment. And I decided, probably a couple of years ago, that there was a direct correlation.
What advice do you have for high school students, both men and women, who are interested in the enterprise computing field?
You want to have some understanding of organizational makeup. How do you go about conflict resolution? How do you go about negotiating? You should have some financial courses as well. Communication's very important. And just teaming and the dynamics of that, leadership, and all the things that go with being a good leader are very important if you're going to take the management path.
What are women doing to help other younger women succeed in the fields?
Clearly, things like the roundtables and the mentoring. And I think just being role models, just showing by example that you can do it. Again, it's not an easy thing to do, but one of the things that's wonderful is that men are struggling with the same conflicts. And it's one of those cases where when you have everybody dealing with the same issues, you get resolutions.
Being a woman, what kind of challenges have you faced during your career in enterprise computing?
When I had finished school, there were a lot of women looking at pursuing careers that they had not been able to do in the past. They were not friendly to women. Mm-hmm. So I did do social work for a few years, and then I decided that to challenge me, I wanted to do something in industry. So I started with IBM as a college recruiter, because one of the things that I recognized was that in order to have women placed in places where they can make a difference, you had to bring them in. So I was responsible for interviewing and recruiting women in computer science and in engineering degrees.
What kind of role has your family played in your academic studies as well as in your career now?
I'll start with my parents. They were my first role models. They were my first mentors, my first heroes. In fact, they believe there's nothing I can't do. And they still believe that. My husband is, I always say, as much a feminist as I am. He, again, believes that I can do anything I want to do. So to join a company that he was already a part of was very important to me and encouraged by him. And then, of course, I have my sons and my daughters-in-law. And I see them having some of the same objectives and goals as I did and as my husband did. And I'm hoping that when I have grandchildren someday, I can impact their interest in dreaming big and succeeding in anything they do.
What kind of organizations do you belong to, and what kind of role have you played in those organizations?
I've been part of organizations both inside IBM as well as outside. Outside of IBM, I'm the president of a board of directors for the Catherine Street Community Center in Poughkeepsie, and I'm on the board of the Hoard Foundation in Danbury, Connecticut, which provides scholarships to minority students.
How do you feel mentoring has helped you personally?
I've always been able to go to certain individuals and inquire, and what you get is honest feedback. In fact, this morning I spent an hour with my mentor, who happens to work in Somers, and I always walk away from there with some good information. And one of the things I keep telling her is that we need to write a book, because everything she asks me to do or suggests that I do, I share with my 13 mentees here.
Looking back at your career, do you feel that you would have done anything differently?
Probably not. Clearly, life is to live. I'm a breast cancer survivor, and so I've always embraced life, but certainly that experience made me realize that everything you do teaches you a lesson. So even when I don't have a good day, I always go home and think, you know what? There was a lesson in what I did or what happened or what occurred. I journal. And so that helps me to put everything in perspective. So probably if someone had said you could have gone this way instead of that way, I probably wouldn't have wanted to, because there was too much going on in the path I took. And I have no regrets as a result of that.
By the way, that video containing all six of those speakers is actually available for public use. It's available. Susan, is it available on our website any longer? But anyways, we can certainly make it available to you. Anyone can steer the ship, when the sea is calm? Which one of the five characteristics? Confidence, maybe? No? All right. Vision? Yeah, perhaps vision, a combination of vision, yes. And speaking about vision, so I want to talk now a little bit about Marist College in terms of what does Marist College, you know, see in terms of its role in terms of helping make future leaders here, future leaders out of our students here at Marist College. Of course, you know, we're not expecting that every graduate from Marist College ends up going in a leadership role, but we want to make certain that they have that opportunity if they actually want to go down that particular path. And so, as I mentioned, in terms of those five characteristics, we talk about your vision, and also in terms of your values. Marist College has the following vision statement. This is our vision statement, our elevate a ride vision statement. Marist is dedicated to helping students develop the intellect, character, and skills required to lead enlightened, ethical, and productive lives in the global community of the 21st century. So, that's how we describe what Marist College is about. And believe me, the president knows that by heart. And every time somebody talks about us going down some particular path, he says, well, how does that relate to our vision? Where does that fit in terms of our vision? I actually like the vision statement. I was actually part of the strategic planning committee that actually came up with that. The last time we did a strategic plan, this has actually changed a little bit this year in that they actually added skills. Skills wasn't part of it before. Every liberal arts type college has their core studies program, has their general education, their liberal studies program. It's usually something that once is in place, it is very, very difficult to change. I came to Marist College in 1980, and at that time, we were discussing a new core. It took about 3 years, a new core was implemented, so probably 1982, 1983. We just 30 years later, voted on a new core this past year. It takes that long to change your core. So I'm going to tell you a little bit associated with the new core at Marist College in terms of what was put in there. And you've got to realize that this is the the joint work of 250 faculty deciding what is important for our students in order for them to be successful members of the global community. So the core consists of, a breadth of study. The core distribution sequence places an emphasis on the students to engage in multiple disciplines across, the liberal arts. Interdisciplinary analysis. Both the interplay among courses in the first year and what's called the interdisciplinary connection. Students are required to take something sort of like a concentration or a minor, which we call interdisciplinary connections, in which they have to take a number of courses that are related, thematically related, but in different disciplines to allow them to be able to communicate across multiple disciplines. Values awareness. Marist College always talks about, values. Values is very important. Here at Marist College, and it's embedded in our core in terms of a number of courses, in terms of how capping courses take place. And then skill development. We want to make certain that all our students who graduate from Marist College have the skills that they need to be successful. I'd said a moment ago that in order to become a leader, you may not end up needing those skills when you get into that particular position, a position of a CIO, but you're certainly going to need technical skills in order to get you there, and some of the skills that we talk about in terms of public speaking, communication, writing, is certainly a very strong component of a leader. You don't need to read this. This is just sort of the summary of the core program here at Marist College that was just instituted. But really, the important part is what I spoke about, on the prior slide. Leadership is the art of getting someone else to do something you want done because he wants to do it. Dwight Eisenhower. One of the five. Leadership is the art of getting someone else to do something you want done because he wants to do it. I now want to tell you a little bit about our programs, you know, here at Marist College in the area of technology. These are really the, you know, the different programs that exist under me, minus the ones associated with mathematics, you know, computer science and software development, game design development, information technology and systems. And we have minors. We have also five-year bachelor master's degrees, as well as master's degrees in software development and information systems. We have no master. I mean, we have no PhDs here at Marist College. When we put together the curriculum associated with our program, we put it together based upon these six goals. These are the goals associated with our program. Very succinctly put. First is prepare students for employment in a technology field or for graduate study in a technology field. That's really the goal of our program. When our students graduate, when we want them to be able to get a job or we want them to be able to go to graduate school. Here at Marist College, about 95% of our students actually end up going the job path as compared to graduate school. Provide students with both the theoretical knowledge and skills-based proficiencies and the five core technology competencies. These are the areas, you know, programming, hardware, communication, data management, and systems. Provide students with fundamental knowledge of business administration and management so the graduates will be able to work effectively within business and organizations. When our students move up in their area, in their particular field, and move into more management, leadership-type roles, one of the things that I talked about in terms of what CEOs are expecting of CIOs is their ability to be able to deal with business models. They have to understand the business component, so we consider it important to our program. Develop interpersonal skills for working effectively on teams. Teamwork and communication, a big part of our program here at Marist College. Develop effective written and oral communication skills. Communication, part of those five items associated with the GUIDO course. Educate students about the behavioral, social, and ethical aspects associated with technology, ethics, values. The very essence of leadership is that you have to have vision. You can't blow an uncertain trumpet. Theodore M. Herzberg. I don't know who Theodore M. Herzberg is. I actually like the quote. Does anybody know him? Who is he? Oh, he's the former president of Notre Dame. Well, we should have known that. Aren't you from Notre Dame? No, this man right here, I thought he was from Notre Dame. Okay. And of course, we know which one that associates with. That's vision. And that's really vision. So, I mentioned all those, CEOs, CTOs, CIOs that graduate from Marist. As early as 8 years ago, none of the people I spoke to were less than vice presidents. Some graduated as long as 30 years ago. Matter of fact, 31 years ago. One graduated, right after I came. Maybe I scared them. I don't know. So I spoke with these people, and I asked them to summarize what they thought was important in their education that allowed them to become a leader. One of the things that, of course, I was hoping they were going to tell me is that what we said was our goals associated with our program, that those things that we stressed were indeed the things that they felt were important to them to become leaders. So, Marist allowed me hands-on real work experience and real responsibility. One of the important components that they talked about, not only this person, was that skill development, hands-on work that they did here at Marist College. communicate. Working in the computer center, they were allowed to communicate to business offices, finance, registrar, alumni, so forth, that they supported. The ability, their skill to be able to communicate with other organizations within Marist College, they found to be extremely successful in their development. Solid foundations in ethics is a Marist trademark and certainly something all future leaders will benefit from. So this person actually graduated from Marist over 25 years ago and felt that that ethics component was something that led to, to their success in terms of a leader. And I have a few other things. Interesting classes with very engaging faculty, to do advanced independent study. Somebody else. Some of the core enterprise computing skills I had acquired and taken for granted while doing so made me far more valuable to my teammates than they had anticipated. This was skill development. This person talked about skill development, going off and being able to be immediately recognized in terms of what their skills were. The ability to work with a team where roles were not predefined but rather developed amongst the group members to achieve a common goal, very important associated with this particular individual. Technology groups often are formed as virtual teams. This person is talking about their current job. Actually formed as virtual teams made up of members of different areas to assist in solving a business problem or find the root cause of a technology defect. These teams define the individual roles themselves. They are not prescribed. The success of these teams is founded in its ability to develop itself, its missions, goals, and milestones, along with communicate to partners, customers, and management along the way. Another. Verbal and written communication was one of the areas I remember being emphasized in several of the final courses. Or verbal and written communication. These people, and some of these people are indeed executive vice presidents at organizations, they weren't very easy to get in touch with and to get to respond back to me. It took me a long time to get these things back. I was very concerned. So that communication thing, I think they needed to work on a little bit. It's because of this early introduction and focus on these soft skills areas that I found myself able to produce the required level of documentation, peer-level training, or customer presentations across several of my roles. So that ability, that communication ability, was extremely important. I believe it was on the emphasis on soft skills and adaptive learning that assisted me as I advanced within my career, faced different technical and personal challenges, and ultimately began to directly manage people. Again, soft skills in various areas of interpersonal communication, written teamwork, and presentation skills, developing the ability to look deep into a problem. Two items came quickly to mind, logical thinking and practical solutions. To take a complex problem, break it down into manageable components, and come up with the simple and practical solutions. Don't tell people how to do things, tell them what to do, and let them surprise you with their results. I'm going to take a glass of water, so this one you have to answer and you have to get it right. Which one of those five do you think? Do we remember the five? What is it? Communication, probably. Confidence is what I would say. Confidence. I mean, you have to have confidence. You have to have confidence in your people. A problem needs to get done. You can't be directing them exactly what it is that they're going to do. You have to be confident that your people are going to be able to do it on their own. Okay, I'm just quickly going to tell you a little bit about some of the programs that we have here at Marist College. The Institute for Data Center Professionals. Anybody ever hear of the Institute for Data Center Professionals? No, all right. Susan. Susan actually runs the Institute for Data Center Professionals. The Institute for Data Center Professionals was actually created through funding from the National Science Foundation. It was actually created about 7 years ago. And the idea of the funding was because of the fact that there was a aging population working in data centers who were going to be leaving, that the leaders in terms of data centers were actually disappearing. And where were these people going to come from? So we actually got funding to create the Institute for Data Center Professionals. It was funded for a certain period of years. It now actually exists as a independent, revenue-generated organization. The only reason I really wanted to tell you about the Institute for Data Center Professionals is that when we put together the program associated with the Institute for Data Center Professionals, the guidelines that we used in terms of putting together our traditional programs, our bachelor's degrees and so forth, were also part of what we did in terms of putting together the programs associated with the Institute for Data Center Professionals. If you look, we have, managing IT organizations, project management. We have courses in terms of accounting for the data center, project management. There's also a lot of technical courses here. By the way, when students are actually going through these programs, the thing that they don't understand is, why do we make them take this course on accounting? Why do we make them take this course on project management? So they don't necessarily see what that importance is going to be, but it is indeed important to make certain that they develop in terms of leaders. Again, some of the other programs that we have, ZOS, part of the Institute for Data Center Professionals. We actually offer these programs literally throughout the world. These are actually some of the countries that have actually taken our courses. And I think I'm done wicked early, so questions.